Welcome back to Proactive London. Well, I'm delighted to have Stephen Lilly from Greencoat UK Wind here in studio in person. Stephen, welcome.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure to have you here, and it is quite a big day for the company. You've just put out your half-year results, and you've been speaking to the investors. So what is it you've been telling them today?
Yeah, so we've highlighted the half-year results. Obviously, it's a half-year result, so we should do that. So £204 million of cash generation, that's off 2.1 terawatt hours of production. 2.1 times dividend cover, net asset value largely flat, about a penny down. There are five drivers behind those that we've talked about in terms of, you know, future power prices are down slightly, inflation's up, that's a good thing for us. We've got discount rates down. We think that in a higher interest rate environment, we should reflect that. We've got some of the assets that we've brought into the business are worth more than we paid for them, etc. So all those things, you know, largely together, that the net asset value being flat. And then we've really wanted to, you know, almost move past that quite quickly, because they're very much as expected, and get onto some points, because we feel as if we've been trading at a discount that isn't appropriate given the drivers behind the business. So we've been talking about the debt position. We think that some investors are worried a little bit about, you know, short-term refinancing done. We did that about a month ago, so we've been able to talk about that. We wanted to talk about power prices and you know, how the fact that, you know, our dividend can be inflated by RPI, even if in the ridiculous world that power prices were only £10 a megawatt hour for the next 5 years, it's just not an issue. So we've wanted to talk about that, and we put some sensitivities in the results about that. We've also wanted to talk about inflation more generally, because I think that people have thought that if inflation is higher, that therefore a discount rates and interest rates are higher, and therefore if the inflation assumptions are higher than expectation, that should be a bad thing. Well, it's actually a good thing, and actually inflation and interest rates that are put in place to cover that inflation effectively offset each other, they balance out, so it's a non-issue for us. And then really the most important thing, those are really about covering concerns that are really non-concerns, is that, you know, we have put our discount rate up. The return from the portfolio now is 11%, taking costs off that, a bit north of 10, and actually 10% return compared to a 10-year gilt, say, the risk-free rate of 5.8% is quite a good return for a business that is, you know, extremely stable and has delivered historically for 10 years. So, you know, we're sort of delighted with that. We think that message of return has probably not been properly understood. So I appreciate this is a long answer to your first question, but we appreciate the return. We think the return probably hasn't been well understood because it's got two components. It's got a dividend that increases with RPI. Well, we've done that 10 times, and we always can. You know, remember the 10-pound per megawatt hour sensitivity. But also we've been reinvesting for 10 years, and that's part of our model. We don't think that's properly understood, because obviously return is a combination of dividend and reinvestment, and we've paid £836 million of dividends in 10 years, and we've reinvested 802. So you can't ignore the 802. We think people probably have been.
I have the sense from talking to you, Stephen, that you personally feel the business is performing well. There's a lot of slightly unfounded concern coming out of the ether there. What do you think is the reason for that concern for people?
Well, I think that in general, I think it's in the market, people have probably been slightly taken aback by interest rates going up. So I think for us, it's been blatantly obvious that was the case. It would have happened at some point. So in our 10 years of life, we've had our discount rates go down by about 1%, and then now they're up from that low, up 2% now. So we're actually higher than we were at IPO, but we started increasing our discount rates about a year ago, so we've been on that journey up to where they are now. We think probably the wider sector hasn't done that, and they've argued for quite a while that asset pricing hasn't changed. Well, yeah, but it depends whether you're competing against yourself or whether you believe in the risk-free rate and the capital asset pricing model, which we do, and therefore as interest rates have gone up, our discount rates need to go up, our return needs to go up, because it needs to be attractive versus the risk-free rate. And so we feel as if we're in a very healthy position, nearly 6% north of the gilt for a business that is extremely stable, is a great return. So we think we should be trading, but we should be trading at a premium. The fact that we're not may well be, you know, the lack of understanding perhaps of the reinvestment, or it could well be that, i.e. people are just looking at the dividend yield, or it could be that we sort of kind of get lumped in a wider sector who hasn't done what we think they have to do, which is lift interest rates and returns higher.
And that would make you a bit of a special case, wouldn't it, if it were true?
Well, that's what we're trying to argue. That's what we think, that's the case. So, yeah. I think it's largely because we have a lot more reinvestment going on. Our dividend cover by design is a lot higher. So actually, if you ignore reinvestment, you know, and treat everyone roughly on the dividend yield, then I'm not surprised. But if you can't ignore 802 million or 806 million rather.
No, certainly not. So I know you're not a man to rest on his laurels in any case. So tell us a bit about what you're expecting from the 6 months to come.
Yeah, I mean, we obviously expect to continue producing. We've got some wind farms we bought recently. Some of those are historic. So we entered into by South Kyle, which will come in on the 31st of August now. We put that in August, sorry, in April 2020. So we bought that then. Dal Candy came in a few weeks ago. We have bought into London Array on Monday. So that's a big project just off the coast from Kent and Essex. And then Kymer Extension, fourth one, we committed a little while ago and that's been built and that'll come in shortly. But the benefit of that, I guess, is that we, given the size we are, we have done four transactions. Some of them are historic, so let's not claim too much from that. But certainly the last two that we entered into, Dal Candy and now London Array, were bilateral. There are reasons why in the current market it's not a homogenous market. You've got certain sellers who are more than happy to do that type of transaction. So we've got a fair bit of value coming from those into the business. And if you look at the accounts, you'll see £132 million write-up in value effectively for a couple of those. And there's a little bit more probably coming from London Array in due course. So that isn't in the NAV, actually. That will correct the 1p down at least. So that ability to buy bilaterally at NAV accretive prices because of particular situations, I think that's because of the size we can do that, the relationships being the leader of the sector, we're comfortable doing that, we know we can do that. You know, ignoring auction processes or going into them and getting kicked out because we're not offering a high enough price, that's okay as well. We can perhaps sell some assets in due course if we need to. You know, we have lots of flexibility. We have £200 million of dividend that we pay per year. So we accrued £102 million of dividend for the first half, paid 96. But we've got another £200 million of cash that's effectively a plus that's been generated every year, which we can either pay down debt or we can buy more assets with, or we can use co-investment alongside as we did in London Array. And so there's bits of activity there, but you know, we're really happy with where we are. We're sending some messages out to the market, removing hopefully some of the concerns and predominantly talking about, you know, return is really important. And it's the mix of an inflating dividend that always can do that and the huge amount of reinvestment that we have designed in our business.
All understood, Stephen. And I am just going to give you the chance now just to get anything else off your chest today since you bothered to make the trip in here.
I think we are an infrastructure business. We're pretty straightforward, hopefully, and well understood. We're going to continue what we've done for 10 years. And, you know, this is 10 years ago, we listed, we had six wind farms, we now have 49, we're nearly 2 gigawatts, well, over 2 gigawatts shortly. This is a business that 10 years ago was political, if you like. It was in the political crosshairs from the then government. Now it's absolutely right in the middle of what everyone knows has to happen, and so it's you know, we're a big part of this ecosystem, and it's a great responsibility, but also a great privilege to do it. So hopefully we can get back to more normal ways, get back to premium, we can raise equity, and we can continue to grow and be a big part of the future.
Fantastic. Well, let me wish you the very best of luck, Stephen, and thank you very much for your time today.
Thank you.